Penguin Audio presents Unstoppable, From Underdog to Undefeated, How I Became a Champion by Anthony Robles and Austin Murphy. Read by Chike Chukwuma. Introduction read by Anthony Robles.
Hi, this is Anthony Robles, national champion, Division I wrestler from Arizona State. Introduction. Mother knows best. There's nothing wrong with you. That was a message I got throughout my childhood from my mom, who bore me at the age of 16, and who told me over and over, no matter what I'd heard in school that day, that I was complete, that I was perfect. Because I was young and trusting, I believed her. And so in perfect seriousness, at the age of 7, I set a goal for myself to someday play for the Oakland Raiders. By the time I was 14, hopping around as a 90-pound defensive tackle on the freshman team, I realized that wasn't going to happen. You've probably heard the saying about how when the Lord closes a door, somewhere he opens a window. The year I quit football was the year I took up wrestling. That trade has worked out okay for me. While I never did play a down for the Raiders, I was invited to deliver a speech to the team on the eve of a game in November of 2011. I'm a guy with a Raider shield tattooed on my left deltoid. So yes, it was a kick sharing my message with the players and coaches, then joining them for dinner, visiting the black hole for the first time in my life, then getting a standing ovation when I was recognized at midfield during the game. Making the experience even sweeter was that after learning my entire family is nuts for the silver and black, my mom also sports a Raiders tattoo, the team flew her and my 4 siblings to Oakland for that game. We were greeted at the airport, then driven to the Raiders headquarters, where we met the players and coaches, then had dinner with the team. I gave a motivational talk to the team, and went really well. While I was on the sideline for the next day's game, my mom was up in one of the suites, chatting up silver and black Hall of Famers Willie Brown and Fred Biletnikoff. It was a dream come true for all of us. It made me truly happy to be able to share these experiences with my family and give back to them for their unconditional love. You see, even though I was born with one leg, my mom never allowed me to use that as an excuse to hold back, to sit on the sidelines, to miss out on life. I grew up doing all the same things that other kids did. I rode a bike, took jiu-jitsu lessons, and raked leaves with my brother for money. I played basketball, baseball, and football. Safety in 7th grade and 8th grade, defensive tackle in 9th. And then the night my friends and I made some dry ice bombs that happened to go off in the park just as a squad car was rolling by, I ran from the cops right alongside my 2-legged buddies. When I say that I ran, I mean that I crutched as fast as I could, which if I do say so myself can be pretty fast. The first time my wrestling coach at Arizona State timed us in the mile, I finished in 10 minutes. I eventually got that down to 8. The first time he sent the team out on one of our preseason 6 a.m. 6-milers, head coach Sean Charles gave me an out. Anthony, you don't have to do this. But I explained to him that I do everything everyone else on the team does. That explains my conflicted reaction to being nominated for the Best Male with a Disability ESPY Award after winning the national championship in my weight class in high school. I was flattered by the nomination, but angered by the name of the category. I don't see myself as disabled. What am I unable to do, you know, other than dance or maybe play professional kickball? When you lose a wrestling match, and I lost a lot early on, you have no one but yourself to blame. That sense of self-reliance and accountability are what initially attracted me to the sport in junior high. My cousin Jesse, who's now a police officer in San Diego, wrestled at South Point High in Tucson. He's the one who introduced me to the sport. When he was first selling me on it, he made this point. The football players are the big guys at high school, but we're the tough guys. They don't like to take us on because they know we can take them down. I like that part of it too. At a time when my own house didn't feel like home, when my stepdad paced around in the cold fury shouting at my mom and me, and worse, wrestling became my refuge. It opened many doors for me, to Arizona State University, to national championships, and to that night in July 2011 at the Nokia, where I was approached by a woman who identified herself as a personal assistant of Serena Williams. Serena wondered if you had time to meet with her, she said. I would have leapt at the opportunity to meet Serena, even if she hadn't been rocking a low-cut, pink mini dress that made a wrestling singlet look baggy by comparison. Well, yes, I replied, I'd like that very much. I had just come off the stage after accepting the Jimmy V Award for Perseverance. As the title of the trophy suggests, and despite it being 1 year after my home life had degenerated to the point where I vowed to quit wrestling to help my family, I hadn't given up, after all. I ended up having a dominant senior year, which resulted in a Tonight Show appearance, 2 ESPYs, I also won Best Male Athlete with a Disability, but I don't talk about that one as much. And a nice jumpstart to my budding career as a motivational speaker. At 5'10", Serena had 4 inches on me before stepping into the 4-inch heel she chose for the ESPYs. That put me at about eye level with her clavicles. I just wanted to tell you that I really liked your story, she told me, once we'd been introduced. While thanking her for the compliment and during the small talk that followed, I was careful to look her directly in the eye. I met a lot of really cool people that night. Jason Kidd, Dirk Nowitzki, Sean Marion of the Dallas Mavericks, Aaron Rodgers of the Green Bay Packers, NBA Rookie of the Year Blake Griffin, all of whom congratulated me and had nice things to say about my brief acceptance speech. At the end of the talk, I recited a poem written for the occasion by my speech coach, Dan Clark. This is how we brought it home. And now, as I go forward with so much more to do, this is my message. Every soul who comes to Earth, with their leg or two at birth, must wrestle his opponents knowing it's not what is, it's what can be that measures worth. Make it hard, just make it possible. And through pain, I'll not complain. My spirit is unconquerable. Fearless, I will face each foe, for I know I am capable. I don't care what's probable. Through blood, sweat, and tears, I am unstoppable. This following spring, I got a medal for courage at the Wrestling Hall of Fame in Stillwater, Oklahoma. It was like walking around a kind of Mount Olympus for wrestlers. Dan Gable was there, as was John Smith, and a host of other Hall of Famers. But I got the biggest kick out of meeting Dan Hodge, a 3-time NCAA champion who's basically the John Heisman of our sport. Every year, the Dan Hodge Award goes to the NCAA's most outstanding wrestler. Even before I met Dan Hodge, I knew all about him. He's famous for his ferociously strong grip. My high school coach Bobby Williams insisted that I develop extraordinary grip strength and frequently cited Dan Hodge and his ability to crush various items, apples, pliers, the bones of his opponents, with his bare hands. He's still got it, by the way. Even at the age of 80, Mr. Hodge was still strong enough to hurt my hand when he shook it. I was flattered that he knew about me, too. He'd been following my career and seen me wrestle in the NCAA championships. At one point, this tough, kind old warrior looked me in the eye and said, "You're the toughest man upstairs I've ever met." It was one of the nicest compliments I've ever gotten. It was Dan Hodge's way of telling me I am unstoppable. But I'm also human. Unstoppable doesn't mean I was never defeated or that I never despaired. It just means I never stayed defeated or gave in to despair. I've had some success because I've also experienced more than my share of failure. The trick is to take it in stride, learn from it, and focus on the next step. Smile and keep moving forward. Come on upstairs and I'll share what I've learned on the journey so far.
Forward by Jay Leno. I met Anthony Robles on July 14, 2011, just before presenting him with the Jimmy V Award for Perseverance at the ESPYs in Los Angeles. We were standing in the wings just off camera. Anthony told me he was a bundle of nerves, but I wasn't buying it. Moments later, I handed him his trophy, then watched him knock his acceptance speech out of the park. I left the theater that night thinking two things. One, I need to redefine what I think of as hardship. And two, get this kid on the show. Not quite a week later, we did. Walking onto the stage at The Tonight Show looks easy enough, but the experience has intimidated more than a few seasoned Hollywood veterans. The lights are bright, the audience is live, and the program is broadcast to millions of people all over the world. But Anthony walked out, flashed that 1,000-watt smile, pulled up a chair, and told his story like he was sitting in his own living room. He was humble, genuine, and made an instant connection with the audience. We talked first about his mother, who is no less extraordinary than her son, the NCAA champion. Judy Robles conceived Anthony when she was 16, yet never considered giving him up for adoption, even when he was born with one leg. She was just a kid herself, really, yet it was up to her to strike the right balance between sheltering her son, a mom's first instinct, and exposing him to the taunts and stares that were bound to follow him. She knew that kids can be mean, and that her boy was going to have a rough go. She also knew it would then be up to her to assure him, every day, that just because he was different, there was nothing he couldn't do. It would have been a daunting challenge for anyone, let alone a teenage mother, but Judy was up for the challenge. To meet Anthony is to see that she nailed it. "My mom raised me with my head in the clouds," he told me on the show that night. "She raised me to believe I could do anything I wanted. And really, I thought I was Superman. The truth is, I'm not sure Superman could do 100 pull-ups in 2 minutes, or bench 320. The Caped Crusader would have killed for Anthony's physique. Have you seen this kid's arms? He makes Michelangelo's David look like Peter in Family Guy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.